incredible prophecy given by Isaiah. And the reason we're doing this is just to prepare our hearts as we enter the communion season to learn more about what Jesus has done for us. And so we'll be looking at Isaiah for a couple of weeks. Judy Anderson grew up as the daughter of missionaries in Zaire. And as a little girl, she recalled going to a day-long ceremony in that African nation where the missionaries were celebrating the 100th anniversary of the arrival of the first missionaries to Zaire. And they had a long day of celebration and speeches and music and celebrating the coming of Christianity through these missionaries to Zaire and the 100th anniversary of the first arrival of missionaries. At the end of the day, one very old man, he was past 100 years old, very slowly made his way to the front and insisted on talking. He wasn't on the schedule, but he insisted that he had something to say that he could not allow to die with him. He knew at his age he wouldn't live much longer. He knew there probably wouldn't be a gathering for a few years of this many people concerning the mission. And he said, there's something that if I don't tell it, it will not be told. I am the last one that knows it. Well, they allowed him a few minutes to speak. And he shared how, as a young child, he heard these stories. He grew up with this knowledge that when the first missionaries came, this particular tribe in Zaire decided they would put them to a test. And so over years of time, they secretly poisoned the missionaries and especially the children of the missionaries little by little so that they would watch how the missionaries handled dying and how they handled the death of their children. And they did this over a period of years, and the missionaries never knew it. The tribe kept this completely to themselves. And this older gentleman stood and told this story, and he felt like, I'm the only one of my generation still alive. Everyone else is dead. No one else is alive that knows what we did back in those days to the first missionaries. The old man summed it up by saying, it was as we watched how they died that we decided we wanted to live as Christians. It was as we watched how they died that we decided that we wanted to live as Christians. Leith Anderson, in writing up this story, concludes by saying, that story had gone untold for 100 years. Those who died painful, strange deaths never knew why they were dying, nor did they ever know what the impact of their lives and deaths had been. But they stayed faithful because they trusted in Christ. They never knew why that was happening. Maybe they assumed it was some tropical disease they didn't have immunities for. They never knew what was going on, and they never knew the impact that they were having by experiencing and going through those painful experiences of dying and watching members of their family die. And today I want to take a look at Isaiah, who 700 years before Christ watched him die. Now, when I say watched him die, I mean he had prophetic insight as to the death of Christ. He prophesied the death of Christ. He maybe even had visions of the death of Christ. Listen to the words of Jesus in John chapter 12, verse 41, or of John, rather, in John chapter 12, verse 41. These things Isaiah said when he saw his glory and spoke of him. He's quoting Isaiah, and he said, these things Isaiah said when he saw the glory of Jesus, and when Isaiah was actually talking about Jesus. We know from Acts chapter 8 that there was this Ethiopian man, and he was in his chariot. He was reading from the scroll of Isaiah. And the Spirit of the Lord said to Philip, go up and talk to that man. And Philip went up to the chariot, and he asked the man, do you understand what you're reading? And he said, how can I understand if no one is here to interpret this for me, to guide this, guide me in this? And so he showed Philip the scroll, and he was reading from these passages in Isaiah. And it says Philip, starting with these passages, was able to tell this man about Jesus as Messiah, as the suffering servant of God, and lead that man to Christ and to faith in Christ. And that man famously said, look, there's water. What's keeping me from being baptized? And I want to be a follower based on these scriptures. Now, I've said this before. I'm going to scare you for a moment, and I will try my best to keep an eye on that clock, and I will try my best to exercise self-control, because what I want to talk to you about is I believe Isaiah saw, and I'm using that word saw as in the prophetic sense, as a prophet, having seen the glory of Jesus and having a word come to him from God, I believe Isaiah saw 9 specific things about Jesus' death. And what we're going to do today is very simple. I want to look at those 9, and of course I can't spend a lot of time on each one, but I want to look at those 9 specific visions that Isaiah had, or words that Isaiah had, about the death of Christ, and then see where they were fulfilled. That's phenomenal when you think about it. 9 specific, 700 years before Christ was ever born, Isaiah saw how he would die. And Isaiah gave specifics about 9 things regarding the death of Jesus Christ. Not just 1 or 2. Some of you might remember this a few years ago. It was on a Sunday, Super Bowl Sunday. By the way, I always come to church on Super Bowl Sunday. You'll be extra blessed if you show up for church on Super Bowl Sunday. And it was on a Super Bowl Sunday, and just jokingly, I said from the pulpit in announcement time, I had another announcement about the birth of a granddaughter, but I said in connection with that, just jokingly, I said the Giants would win by 3. The New York Giants would win the Super Bowl by 3. Yes, Tony. And at the end of the game, they went on this incredible drive with a miracle catch. A guy caught a ball on his helmet to set up the winning touchdown. That guy was a believer, by the way, the guy that pinned it to his helmet, Tyree. And of course, you know, Eli Manning threw the touchdown, and then the Patriots couldn't score in their last possession. So they won by 3. But it's amazing how many people came up to me afterwards and said, hey, will you tell me the score next year's Super Bowl? Or what's the Super Bowl this year? Has it got nearer to the Super Bowl? I don't know if they wanted to maybe lay a little money down, thinking I had some insight. And all it was a jest. It was just in jest. It was just joking. And just one fact about one event I got right, and people thought I was an expert. How about Isaiah, 700 years, 9 specific things about Christ, about how he would die, some of which had to do with forms of execution that people of 700 years prior would not have been all that even familiar with. That he would be executed in Roman style when Roman wasn't even over them at that time. I mean, incredible. Well, let's read this long. I'm going to read some chunks of passages here, and then I'm going to give you the 9. And next week, we're going to follow up on this, because Isaiah not only sees how Jesus is going to die, but Isaiah has incredible insight as to what those things and what his death accomplished. So it's going to be a 2-part study today. Well, we begin with a simple passage. I'm going to jump around just a little bit. Isaiah chapter 50, verses 5 and 6. Isaiah 50, 5 through 7, rather. The Lord God has opened my ear, and I was not rebellious, nor did I turn away. I gave my back to those who struck me, and my cheeks to those who plucked out the beard. I did not hide my face from shame and spitting. For the Lord God will help me, therefore I will not be disgraced. That's talking about the coming Messiah, or as others have titled it, the suffering servant. Now go to Isaiah chapter 52. It's a long passage about suffering servant, but I'm selecting some. Isaiah chapter 52, beginning with verse 13 all the way through chapter 53. And in the original, there were no chapter divisions, but Isaiah 52, 13. Behold, my servant shall deal prudently. He shall be exalted and extolled and be very high. Just as many were astonished at you, so his visage was marred more than any man, and his form more than the sons of men. So shall he sprinkle many nations. Kings shall shut their mouths at him, For what had not been told them they shall see, and what they had not heard they shall consider. Who has believed our report? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant, and as a root out of dry ground. He has no form or comeliness, and when we see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him. He is despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, and we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we did not esteem him. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way. The Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted. He opened not his mouth. He was led as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before its shears is silent, so he opened not his mouth. He was taken from prison and from judgment, and who will declare his generation? For he was cut off from the land of the living. For the transgressions of my people he was stricken, and he has made his grave with the wicked, but with the rich in his death, because he has done no violence, nor was any deceit found in his mouth. Yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He has put him to grief. When you made his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed, he shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. He shall see the travail of his soul and be satisfied. By his knowledge, my righteous servant shall justify many, for he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will divide him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he poured out his soul unto death. He was numbered with the transgressors, and he bore the sin of many and made intercession for transgressors. What a phenomenal passage of Scripture. Isaiah, seeing 700 years into the future, seeing 9 specific things about the death of Christ. All 9 of them are very significant for us today. Let's jump into them. I want to give you them and study them more on your own. We only have time to mention them briefly and move on to the next one. But I believe you'll see this building. All of this shows us the incredible accuracy and authority of the Scripture. Who can doubt that the Scriptures are inspired when we see 700 years in advance such detail? Who can question the glorious achievement of Christ on the cross when it was a part of this divine plan? Isaiah spelling it out as God gave it to him 700 years in advance. Number one, Isaiah saw Jesus despised and rejected. Now, we looking back say, well, of course he was despised and rejected. But I want to remind you, the people of Jesus' day were looking for a Messiah. And there'll be some scriptures in your study guide, but the Messiah they were looking for was to come and deliver Israel from all of their enemies, was to bring this universal peace and prosperity, was to be a great political, military leader. That's the kind of Messiah they were looking for. They were looking for a Messiah who would usher in the age of the Spirit. God's Spirit would return again to his people. They were looking for a Messiah who not only would pour out his Spirit, but would bring peace, and the lion and the lamb would lay down together. And all nations would come up to Jerusalem to worship the Lord. They were looking for this Messiah who was great, whom the nations of the world would bow down to. And certainly he would be Israel's hero. And there were times in the ministry of Jesus they wanted to force him to be king, because they were looking for this kind of Messiah. It was totally unthinkable that the Messiah who would come would be rejected. Yet notice what Isaiah said in Isaiah chapter 53 very accurately. He says, who will believe our report? Look at verse 3. He is despised and rejected of men. He goes on to say, we did esteem him smitten, stricken of God. In other words, the people are going to say, this man is cursed by God, and he's getting what he deserves on that cross. That's how rejected and despised Jesus was to be, that they would see him on that cross and they would say, this man is being cursed by God, and he deserves to be cursed by God. He's a blasphemer. Notice how they railed at him at the cross. Oh, you saved others. Come save yourself. Oh, if you really are the Son of God, come down from that cross. How they ridiculed him. How they mocked him. They did not receive him. He was despised and rejected. Isaiah 49:7. To him whom man despises, to him whom the nations abhor. Isaiah said the Messiah would be despised by people. He would be abhorred by the nations. And yet that's not what Israel was looking for. Psalm 22:6. The Messiah on the cross cries out, I'm a worm, I'm not a man. I'm the reproach of men, I'm despised of people. Many times we used to sing this old chorus, this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. But the passage that comes from Psalm 118, verse 22 is the verse I'm referring to, and then it follows that little chorus we made. It says, the stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. Jesus was the stone that the builders rejected. John 12. So many signs did he do, yet they did not believe in him. Matthew 13. They rejected him. They were offended at him. Luke 6:14. They derided him. John 10:20. They said he's got a devil. Matthew 8:34. They told him to leave the city. Remember after he delivered that man from the demons and they went into the pigs? Jews aren't even supposed to like pigs, right? But when that herd of pigs went into the, jumped off the car, they wanted Jesus to leave. They didn't want him. After his first sermon in Luke chapter 4, they tried to throw him over a cliff. In Luke 23, around the time of his trial, crucifixion, they were crying, away with him, we'd rather have Barabbas, crucify him. They railed on him to come down from the cross. Here, Jesus, we know him as the Messiah. But he was not the Messiah Israel was looking for. He was despised. He was rejected. John put it this way. He came unto his own, and his own received him not. Isaiah, number one, saw that he was despised and rejected. Number two, Isaiah saw the scourging of his back. Isaiah saw the scourging of his back. Now in the Bible there are two types of scourging. There is the scourging by the Jews that Paul received 5 times. And this was a punishment given out by the synagogue for heretics and blasphemers. And they were not allowed to go beyond 39 lashes. But the Romans had a scourging that was much worse. The Roman scourging was these whips with all kinds of bones and metal and sharp objects and weights that would literally rip the flesh off of the victim's back. And it was a form of torture trying to get people to talk. Notice in the scripture you'll read like Pilate says, I turned him over to be examined. Do you know what that means, examined? That means they're going to torture him to try and get information out of him. And they would also scourge people before they crucified them so that they would die quicker. Because the scourging was such a horrible punishment. They were about to scourge Paul in Acts 22, a Roman form of scourging. And he quickly appealed to his citizenship, and they didn't do it. See, this was a different form of scourging than the 39 lashes of the Jews that Paul referred to in 2 Corinthians 11:24. A man by the name of McDermott has written a book, and he bases, not a book, but an article based on 2 books, A Doctor at Calvary by Pierre Barbette, a medical doctor, and then another book by Frederick Zugi, who's not only a medical doctor, he's a PhD in forensics, and they give some information about this, the effects of this scourging. The weight of the metal or bone objects, I'm quoting, at the end of the leather thongs would carry them to the front of the body as well as to the back and the arms, the shoulder, legs down, including the calves. Bits of metal would dig deep into the flesh, ripping small blood vessels, nerve, muscle, and skin. The injuries sustained during scourging were extensive. Blows to the upper back and rib cage area caused rib fractures, severe bruising in the lungs, bleeding into the chest cavity, partial or complete pneumothorax, which is puncturing the lung, causing it to collapse. Much blood would be lost. The victim would vomit, experience tremors, seizures, fainting. They go on to say that these lashes could actually, and often actually, could lacerate the liver and the spleen. This was a mangling of the human body. This was not like the Jewish lashes in the synagogue. And there, 700 years in advance, Isaiah saw Jesus being scourged. It says, by his stripes we are healed. The chastisement, that word chastisement, Pilate said, I'm going to just chasten him and then release him. Chastisement, that meant scourging. This chastisement of our peace was upon him, Isaiah 53:5. And then in Isaiah 50:5, Isaiah quotes the Messiah as saying, I offered my back to the smiters. And of course, Matthew 27, they took him out and scourged him. Other references in Mark and John, we know that Jesus was scourged. Yet 700 years before, Isaiah saw this form of punishment being used on the suffering servant of God. And it was a Roman form of punishment that wasn't even that commonly known to the Jews of Isaiah's day. It was a Roman form of punishing or torturing a man. Do you think that's just coincidence? You think that was just a lucky guess, like Giants will win by 3? No, this is the Spirit of God writing Scripture. This is God carrying out his plan. Isaiah saw the scourging of his back. Number 3, Isaiah saw the disfiguring of his face. Isaiah saw the disfiguring of his face. It was foretold in Isaiah 52:14. He was marred beyond human likeness, one translation says. Another translation of 52:14, his appearance was so disfigured beyond that of a man. Isaiah saw the disfiguring of his face beyond recognition, beyond that of a man. Now, I am not sure that this is the case. I know Chuck Smith was quoted as referring to maybe, and he said maybe. We don't know this affirmatively. But maybe this is why on the road to Emmaus they didn't recognize him. I'm not sure that really fits. But that's a thought, that his face was so disfigured. Look at what it says in Isaiah 52:2. We turned our faces away. Now that is a phrase that means in revulsion. Now, something seems so horrible I can't look at it. We have no idea the disfiguring of the face of Jesus because it is fulfilled in such simple phrases in the Scripture. We have a tendency to just read right over it. But when you consider the totality of what they did to his face and head, it says he was marred beyond recognition. How is this fulfilled? Well, this didn't disfigure him, but Isaiah 50:6 talks about spitting in his face. You'll see in the Gospels how they spat in his face. Chapter 50, verse 6 says that they pulled the beard out of his hair. Can you just picture men as Jesus is there reaching and grabbing a chunk of his beard and just ripping it out until his beard was gone? One after another, ripping out his beard. Even the crown of thorns. There's been some research done by these forensic experts talking about what the crown of thorns would do to that main nerve that goes through your face, the excruciating pain that it would cause as those thorns were injuring that main nerve in his face, and the profuse bleeding that would come from his head. But look at Matthew chapter 27. Just try, we read over this so quickly, but see what they were doing. Matthew chapter 27, and they stripped him, verse 28, and put a scarlet robe on him. When they had twisted a crown of thorns, they put it on his head and a reed in his right hand. And they bowed the knee before him and mocked him, saying, Hail, King of the Jews! Then they spat on him, and they took the reed and struck him on the head. And when they had mocked him, they took the robe off him, put on his own clothes on him, and led him away to be crucified. John 18:22 also talks about striking him about the face. Mark chapter 14, verse 65 in the New American Standard Bible footnote said, blows to his face with rods. They took hard, rod-like objects and kept pounding him in the face. We sometimes assume it was when he had this cloth over him, but maybe not all the time. But we know they definitely beat him in the face, plucking the hairs out of his beard, putting that crown of thorns on his head. Can you see the profuse bleeding and then the battering of his face? He didn't even look like a man. He was marred beyond recognition as a man. Isaiah saw that 700 years before it happened and was carried out by people that couldn't have cared less what Isaiah said. Oh, how can we doubt the scriptures when we see such accuracy as this? How can we doubt the scriptures when we see 700 years? How can we doubt the love of Jesus, knowing this was what he would experience, and this isn't even the beginning of it? This week that we're looking at is only the physical aspect of it. That which is non-physical is far beyond our comprehension. The severing of the relationship with his Father, the bearing of our sins and suffering of our wrath. This is just the physical. And oh, how horrible even was the physical. So I've given you two, three, now number four. Isaiah saw the scarring of his hands. Isaiah saw the scarring of his hands. Go back, we didn't read this in our text, but go back, Isaiah 49. Isaiah chapter 49. It says, "Oh, sing, O heavens, be joyful, O earth, and break out in singing, O mountains. The Lord has comforted his people and will have mercy on his afflicted. But Zion said, the Lord has forsaken me, and the Lord has forgotten me. Can a woman forget her nursing child and not have compassion on the son of her womb? Surely they may forget, yet I have not forgot you. See, I have inscribed you on the palms of my hands." Isn't that interesting? See? I haven't forsaken you. Look at my hands. Isaiah saw something about the hands that he described as an inscription upon the hands. The scarring of his hands. Zechariah 13, 6 and 7. "And one will say to him, what are these wounds between your hands?" It's an awkward phrase in the Hebrew. "Then he will answer, those with which I was wounded in the house of my friends." And he went on to say, "They will strike the shepherd and the sheep will scatter." Definitely in reference to his crucifixion. Definitely in reference to his arrest and the scattering of his people at his arrest and his crucifixion. But notice they said to him, "What are these wounds on your hands? What are these wounds on your body? Specifically your arms, your hands." "It's when I was wounded in the house of my friends." Do you remember how this was fulfilled? Of course, the nails piercing his hands. But even after the resurrection, do you remember what we call doubting Thomas? He said, "I won't believe until I can poke into the holes in his hands, the scars in his hands." Isaiah saw that 700 years before. Isaiah saw the scarring of his hands. Leslie B. Flynn tells this story. It was written up in our Daily Bread devotional of an orphan boy who was living with his grandmother when their house caught on fire. The grandmother knew the boy was in an upstairs room, and she went back into that burning house to rescue her grandson. Yet on the stairway, she couldn't get by, and she ended up perishing in the flames. She died in that fire. And hearing the screams of the little boy, an old man, older man, not real old, but an older man was walking by, and he heard this boy and knew this boy must be up in that room, and he climbed a drain pipe on the outside of the house, went in through a window, grabbed that child, and then came back down that drain pipe with that child and saved the child's life. Sometime later, the court was having to decide what would be done with his child. He was already taken in by a grandmother. His parents had already died. Now his grandmother dies. Three leading citizens from that town applied to take him in and to have him, and they were to stand before the judge and show why they could best provide for this child. There was a farmer, there was a teacher, and there was a wealthy man, and they all gave their arguments. The little boy just sat there, head down, not even looking around. After they gave their arguments, an older man that nobody seemed to know walked in that room, and the boy got up and ran to him and embraced him and put his arms around him. That man just held out his hands for the judge to see. They were all scarred up. He was the man that climbed down that pipe, up that pipe and down that pipe, scarring his hands. That was his way of saying, I love this child. That was his way of saying, they've told you why. They can give him education or money or prestige, but I love this child. Look at my hands. And they awarded that man custody of the boy. And that story moves us, and that story shows us the love of a man. How much greater is the love of God, who says, I'll never forget you. Look at my hands. You doubt that I could ever forget you? Look at my hands. I have inscribed you on the palms of my hands. You're written there forever. Isaiah saw that. 700 years before those nails ever pierced his hands, Isaiah saw that. Number five, Isaiah saw the piercing of his side. Isaiah saw the piercing of his side. Isaiah chapter 53, verse 5, the word for wound, he was wounded. Isaiah 53, 5, but he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The word wounded in the Hebrew, shalal, it means to wound fatally, to bore through or to pierce. To wound fatally, to bore through or to pierce. Remember, as he was hanging on that cross, and they wanted to make sure he was dead, so they sent the soldiers out with large mallets to smash the legs of those on the cross so they could no longer hold themselves up and keep themselves breathing. They came to Jesus, and the prophets had said not a bone would be broken. They came to him and found that he was already dead, and they were amazed he was already dead. So one of them took a spear and rammed it in his side and pierced all the way through. Through the chest cavity, maybe even hitting his through his heart, into his lungs, because blood and water came out. We won't even get into that. Forensics people, doctors have speculated what that might have been all about. Maybe the bursting of that pericardiac sac, or maybe the fluid grown up around his lungs in the scourging, whatever. But they took that spear and they pierced him through. I'm not suggesting clear through to the other side, but that was a piercing. Zechariah chapter 12, verse 10. And I will pour out on the house of David and on the inhabitants of Jerusalem the spirit of grace and supplication. Then they will look upon me whom they pierced. Yes, they will mourn for him, and as one mourns his only son, and grieve for him as one grieves for a firstborn. He said they will look upon the one they pierced. Revelation 1, 7. Probably not in your study guide, but write that one down too. Revelation 1, 7. And certainly it was fulfilled when they took that spear and they thrust it into his side. And blood and water came out. And then again, quoting Doubting Thomas in John 20, 25, he said, unless I thrust my hand in his side. How big a hole was that if he could put his hand in there? Unless I can put my hand in his side, Isaiah saw the piercing. He was wounded. He was pierced through for our transgressions. Number six, Isaiah saw that Jesus was killed among sinners and buried with the rich. Isaiah saw that the Messiah, Jesus, the suffering servant, would be killed among sinners and buried with the rich. It was foretold in verse 9, and they made his grave with the wicked, but with the rich at his death. And then in verse 12, therefore I will divide him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong. And you know from the gospel record, the scriptures are there before you in the study guide, that he was crucified in between two thieves. He was killed among sinners, in between sinners, in the midst of sinners, as a sinner. But Joseph of Arimathea, a rich man, came asking for his body, taking that body down from the cross and laying it in his own tomb. Many of you have had that great privilege of going to Jerusalem and seeing the garden tomb. As you go to one corner of that area called the garden tomb, you can look over a small fence and down to a bus station owned by some Arabs. And there you can see the rocks that look like a skull, Golgotha. Then you can go to that garden tomb. And in Mark's version of the resurrection, it talks about entering the tomb and seeing one sitting on the right side. A lot of tombs, most commonly, the body would be laid directly in front of you, but this tomb, it was on the right side. You go to the Garden Tomb, it's on the right side. Both outside the city walls, Golgotha, the old city walls, Golgotha, and the Garden Tomb. And I believe there was where Joseph of Arimathea laid him. They can show you, if you go to the Garden Tomb, they can show you how very hastily it was carved out. They can tell how the end of where they would lay that body was carved out in haste. There's still markings there that weren't smoothed out. How do they know it was in haste? Why is that significant? Because obviously the man it was originally prepared for was shorter. So a larger body was placed there, so they had to scrape it out at the last moment. It wasn't his tomb. It was the tomb of a rich man. Isn't that amazing? Isaiah saw that 700 years before. That he would be killed among sinners, but he would be buried amongst the rich. And here this Messiah, all he would have left at the end of his life was a seamless garment that they gambled over. Yet he was placed in a rich man's tomb. Isaiah saw that 700 years before. Number 7. Isaiah saw that Jesus' death would be voluntary. Isaiah saw that Jesus' death would be voluntary. Look at chapter 50, verse 6 of Isaiah. It says, I gave my back to the smiters. I offered my back to the smiters. He voluntarily took that punishment. But Isaiah chapter 53, verse 7 gives an interesting phrase. It says, he opened not his mouth. He was like a lamb, a sheep, going to the slaughter, just silently going to the slaughter. Now, I believe that was fulfilled in two ways. He opened not his mouth. Remember in John's version of the arrest, in John chapter 18, this large contingency of soldiers come to get him. How many, we're not sure, but a large group of armed soldiers come to get him. He's there praying in the garden, and he says, who are you looking for? Who are you looking for? And they said, Jesus of Nazareth. He said, I am he. Boom, they all fell backwards. Remember that? I love that. That is just so great. Just, I'm he. Boom. All these soldiers. I just hear all their equipment falling and clanging, and then they stagger to get back up and trying to figure out what just hit them. But you notice he asked them a second time. The second time he said, I'm he. And then that second time they didn't fall down. That second time he did not exert his power. He allowed them to take him then. If he knocked him down the first time, why couldn't he knock him down again? Why couldn't he just keep him down and walk away? Because he was voluntarily going to that trial. He was voluntarily. And then he said, when Peter tried to fight, remember Peter taking out his sword? Jesus said, and he did lop off the ear, and Jesus healed the guy. And then Jesus said, put away your sword, Peter. Put it away. You live like that, you're going to die like that. Put it away. Could I not right now call legions of angels? My Father would send them. What would have happened if Jesus had just said, send the angels? They would have come. But he opened not his mouth. He submitted to the one he trusted. But more so, this is applicable to when he was before the high priest in Matthew 26, before Herod in Luke 23, before Pilate again, before Pilate in Matthew 27, how he would not offer a legal defense. He was given a chance to offer a legal defense, and he opened not his mouth. He would not give a legal defense. That doesn't mean he didn't say an answer or a word. It means he did not give a legal defense. And Pilate marveled that he wouldn't even try to give a legal defense. He opened not his mouth. And even to Pilate, he said, you have no authority over me. You couldn't do anything to me except there's someone who's over, who gives the authority. If he hadn't given this authority, you could do nothing to me. 1 Peter put it this way. He didn't revile when he was reviled. He didn't open up his mouth. He just committed his soul. He committed his soul to God. The submission of Christ. He could have called those angels and they would have come. In John 10, he talks about the good shepherd laying down his life for his sheep. Giving his life for his sheep. He went on in that same John 10 passage to say, nobody takes my life from me. I give it. Nobody takes it from me. I give it. In Isaiah, 700 years before, Isaiah says, He opened not his mouth. He was like a lamb, silent, like a sheep, silent, going to the slaughter. Knowing he was going to the slaughter, he would not use his power to save himself. He would not call those angels. He would not knock them all down again. He would not offer a legal. You think he could have, the wisdom he had, so many times he had such incredible wisdom to answer the critics, to stop their mouths. Couldn't he have said something incredibly wise when he was on trial? But he didn't. He opened not his mouth. They did not take his life. He gave it. And he gave it for you. Isaiah saw that. Number 8. Isaiah saw that Jesus would die young and without children. Yet, I want you to hang on to that yet. Isaiah saw that Jesus would die young and without children. Yet, look at Isaiah chapter 53, verse 8. It says, he was taken from prison and from judgment. And who will declare his generation? For he was cut off from the land of the living. Because there's no one to talk about his offspring because he was cut off. He would die young and without children. Now, was that fulfilled? Well, we know that Jesus never married. We know that he began his ministry at age 30. And was killed at age 33. That's young. How many of you agree? That's young. So he would die young and without children. Yet Isaiah said that he would have children. Yet, number, letter C, yet he would have children. Wait a minute. You just said he was cut off young. Without being married, without having children, yet he would have children. Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6, the prophesied Messiah, his name shall be Wonderful Counselor, Everlasting Father. Yet he will have children. Look at Isaiah again in chapter 10, verse 10 of chapter 53. Yet it pleased the Lord, 10 of 53, yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He has put him to grief. When you make his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed and prolong his days. He's going to have, seed means offspring. He shall see his seed and prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper his hand. He shall see the labor, the travail of his soul, and be satisfied. Labor, travail, like the pain of a woman giving birth. Here Isaiah seems to contradict himself. Isaiah says he's going to be cut off, so nobody there. Who's going to declare his generation because he's cut off? But then he's going to see his seed. You say, how can this be? Isaiah said, and he was about talking directly about his own family, in Isaiah 8:18, he said, I and the children the Lord gives me will be as a testimony, as a sign. But Hebrews chapter 2 quotes that. Hebrews chapter 2 quotes Isaiah 8 about Jesus, for it was fitting for him for whom are all things and by whom are all things, in bringing many sons to glory, to make the captain of their salvation perfect through sufferings. For both he who sanctifies and those who are being sanctified are all of one, for which reason he is not ashamed to call them brethren, saying, I will declare your name to my brethren in the midst of the assembly. I will sing praise to you, and again I will put my trust in him, and again, here am I and the children whom God has given me, quoting Isaiah, talking about Jesus. Here am I and the children whom God has given me. And then it goes on to talk about how Jesus became flesh and blood, because that's what we are. To die for us, to set us free from the fear of death and from the power of the devil. He's going to have children. Genesis 3:29, and if you are Christ, then you are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. John 1, 11 and 12, he came unto his own, and his own received him not. But as many as received him, gave he to them the right to be the children of God. He's going to have children. And you might say, how can this be? Well, Jesus' children must be born the same way as Jesus was born, of the Spirit. How was Jesus born? How did Jesus come into the world? Mary cries out, how can this be? I don't know a man. How can this be? The power of the Holy Spirit will overshadow you. That which is within you will be conceived by the Holy Spirit. Jesus, we could say, was born of the Spirit. How are you born into the God's family? How do you become a child of God? Jesus said, John 3, don't marvel at this that I say unto you, you must be born again. That which is flesh, but that which is of the Spirit is Spirit. You must be born of above. You must be born of the Spirit. And so in the same way that Jesus was born of the Spirit, he has children today that are born of the Spirit. And Isaiah saw 700 years before Christ and many more years before you that you would be a child, that Jesus would have children, that you would be one of them. Are you one of them? Are you one of his children? Have you been born of his Spirit? Can he see the travail of his soul in you and be satisfied? Can he see the result of all of his pain and all of his suffering and be satisfied? He is satisfied when he sees you as his child. That is what brings him satisfaction. The travail, the labor of his soul is you as his child. Isaiah saw that he would die young and without children, and yet he would have children. He would see his seed. They would prolong his days. His seed is you, if you're born of his Spirit. You're his child. He's your everlasting Father. Hallelujah. And then ninth, Isaiah saw, this is from Isaiah 52:13. Isaiah saw that Jesus would be raised and exalted. Oh, how we need to get a hold of this, not just because it's Easter in a couple weeks, but how we need to get a hold of this, that Isaiah saw that Jesus would be raised. He would be exalted. We see that in chapter 52 of Isaiah. He will be exalted, verse 13. Behold, my servant shall deal prudently. He shall be exalted and extolled and be very high. Even before some of these other details of the suffering of Jesus in Isaiah 53, Isaiah saw that this suffering servant, yes, he will suffer, but he will be exalted. He will be exalted far above. He will be exalted very high. In Ephesians 1:20-21 says, which the power of God, which he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in heavenly places, far above all principality and power and might and dominion, every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in that which is to come. Isaiah saw that. 1 Peter 3:22, through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God, angels and authorities and powers having been made subject to him. Notice how these two New Testament passages kind of link together the resurrection and the ascension, the exaltation of Jesus. And Isaiah saw it. He will be exalted. He will be very high. He saw that not only Jesus would be the suffering servant that would have his face disfigured and his side pierced and his hands scarred and his face battered beyond recognition and his back lashed open. He saw all of that. But he saw that in light of the glorious truth that this suffering servant would be raised and would be exalted. And Jesus made that known. He said, I'm going to go to Jerusalem. I'm going to be rejected by the religious authorities. They're going to scourge me and they're going to crucify me, but I'll be raised. I'll be raised up on the third day. But Isaiah already saw that. 700 years before. Philippians chapter 2, 9-11 says, therefore God has also highly exalted him and given him the name which is above every name, that the name of Jesus every knee should bow, those in heaven and those on earth and those under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Isaiah saw that 700 years before, and now we worship him as the risen Lord, the exalted Savior, the great and mighty Messiah, the one that Israel didn't recognize, but we've embraced by faith. This stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone, and this is the day that the Lord has made. What day? Not just today, but the day that the stone was rejected, that day was made by the Lord. That house that it now has been raised up with that rejected stone as its chief cornerstone, that day was made by the Lord. So we will rejoice and be glad in it. We talk about Good Friday. Now do you see how good it really was? It was prophesied by Isaiah 700 years before. It was all orchestrated by God himself. It was all under his control so that we might be the children of God, so that we might be born of the Spirit and become the children of Jesus, knowing him as our everlasting Father. Easter is not just about pretty dresses and little eggs for kids to run around after. It's about what Isaiah saw. It's about how it all ended with the exaltation of Jesus. And so, Connie, would you come to close us in song, and Michael, close us in prayer. But as we do that, are you his child? He did all this for you. He did all this so that you would be what he saw and what he sees as the outcome of the labor, of the pain. He shall see the travail of his soul and be satisfied. We look at the horrors of the crucifixion. We look at the total agony that he went through and just how terrible it all was. You know what Jesus would say? When I see you as my child, it was worth it all. When I see you as mine, when I see you worshiping me, when I see you honoring me, it was worth it all. He will see the travail of his soul, and he will be satisfied. You say, why should I live for God? Not for your sake. Live for God. For his sake, to see, for him to see the travail of his soul and be satisfied. Why should you worship him? So he can see the travail of his soul and be satisfied. In all of our frailties, in all of our imperfections, we're his children. In all of our carnality, and even in some of our sinfulness, not justifying sin, but God takes us as we are. He says, you're my child. I did this for you. I did all this so that you could be my child with all your flaws and sins and everything. I did all that so that you'd be my child. And I'm satisfied. That all of my suffering was worth it. And I see you as my child. Let's stand together, shall we? And let's just.